Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. A few housekeeping items before we get started. Folks in the audience, you're in listen-only mode. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to type them into the question or chat sections, respectively. We will take some time to answer any questions you may have after Sarah's presentation. For those seeking CE credit, please make sure to focus your attention to today's presentation and answer the polling questions in order to receive credit. Without further ado, I'll turn the microphone over to Maryland State Manager Ron Calcerano.
Welcome back, everyone, to our monthly webinars. I know it's been a couple months since we've taken off. I hope you're all having a happy and healthy new year. We're excited today to have Security Title's very own agency rep, Sarah Whitby, as a presenter today. Sarah will be discussing how to navigate through difficult unreleased mortgages. And I think you're going to find it informational and somewhat exciting. So without further ado, Sarah, take it away.
Thank you, Ron and Anshi. Good afternoon. Today we'll be discussing navigating difficult unreleased mortgages, and we are looking forward to this presentation. Let's get going. Okay. Anshi, am I in control of the screen? Oh, there we go. Sorry. All right. So with unreleased mortgages, a lot of you already know this, but it's an issue of title being clear or not. Without a clear title, there can be no title insurance and no sale. So it's deal or no deal, literally. Looks like I have to double click. Okay. When you're scheduling a settlement, this is the question whether or not you can settle on time if you discover an unreleased mortgage. Hopefully discover it early on and you have enough time to resolve it. Most of you know what a property abstract is, but for those of you who don't, there's a definition for you and what an unreleased mortgage is. Don't like to assume anyone knows what everything is. So just taking a second for that. Obviously we have land records in the circuit courthouse, and we have how much money and how much time is it going to take to resolve an unreleased mortgage. A lender has typically 60 to 90 days after they are paid in full to release the mortgage or deed of trust, but as a lot of you know, they don't often, or oftentimes we may see that they are not keeping up with that, and or they send the release back to the borrower who has no clue to send it on to the land records and get it recorded. And then they find themselves in a situation where they have to deal with a problem at the time of sale or refinance. Now, most of you know what a mortgage loan is and a loan policy of title insurance. You know what a loan policy does, that it protects the lender's interest. An owner's policy of title insurance actually ensures the owner's right to the property, and that is why people should get an owner's policy who are purchasing a property. That way, they're not just protecting the lender, they're protecting themselves in case something like a former owner's mortgage did not get released. And we'll get into that a little bit later about why that is. With the release, it's about if it's paid in full or not. And we can assume that it is, but that's not going to get us to the table. We have to see that wonderful release documentation filed in the land records, and we want to see where did the money go. And so we need to see if it's released, and if it's not released, we want to see the money, right? So just have a little fun character here from Tom, and payment required. This is the process of getting a release recorded. Obviously, people take out a mortgage, then they pay it in full. Then there's the release preparation from the lender. The release gets sent, and then hopefully to the land records, and it gets recorded properly with the correct information. There can be a problem from step two to the end. It can go to the wrong county. It can go to the client or the borrower, and they don't know what to do with it. And so now we have to see what happens with that and dig in a little bit to see if we can help them get to the table. An unreleased mortgage is a title problem. It's a cloud on title. If it's fully paid, it will say so on the land records. Otherwise, it's pretty much locked up, as you can see there, until everything is fixed. The release is literally the key to the lock. So when we find a release on title, most of you have a little moment of, oh no, and when do we have to close and how much time do we have? And all these questions start popping in your head. And most of you know how to sort of take the reins, but I'm going to dig in a little bit about maybe some things that you don't actually know. Hopefully they'll shed some light on that detail. If you really want to dig in and you're new to the title business, or you need a refresher, I recommend everyone just sort of pull out the book, right? Go to your statute, Maryland Annotated Code Real Property Statute 3-105, and look at the recording of releases. This is a lot of what we're discussing today. I'm not going to read it to you verbatim. I think that's very boring. So here we go. This is an actual example. Being an investigator, you're digging in to see what can you do to help the client. Now you see an unreleased mortgage, you do actually have some information in front of you. So get it out and start digging in that information. Most importantly, you look at the top. This is an actual example of an unreleased mortgage. This one was unreleased. And you can see on here, there's some evidence, if you will. And you'll see that the title company's name was Bay Home Title. And the likely file number is also right under that. Most of you put your file number on your deeds of trust so that you can track things down and keep things, you know, in decent order in your office, and as do other title companies as well. And the reason why you want to know that is because you can now see what to do about this release. Now, you can also see a probable loan number. This is just an actual deed of trust that is unreleased. That title company is not going to be helpful to us because they did not pay off this loan. They had the mortgage opened. And so just keeping that in mind, you'll see the recording date and the library and folio. The next thing you want to do is literally get out your paper and pencil and start writing down what you know about this detail. So get out your handbook, your wonderful notepad, and just start looking in. Here we have George Flamini in Harford County. And you will look at the chain of title. And here we have it in the land records. Went right straight to the land records and started ruling out what things are in this. So you'll see in May 17, 2002, this was recorded, book 3980-1, is their unreleased mortgage. And there was two assignments, and then you'll see a deed of trust that was recorded after that in April of 2003. So that's about a year later. You want to take a quick look at that and see what can you discover from that information. Obviously, we have another one that was recorded behind that, and that's important to note because when you have a re-recording situation and you have a release, you need to make sure that the re-record and the original recording is referenced in your release correctly. Otherwise, you're not completely released, and you want to make sure that is done correctly. Okay. Doesn't happen all the time, but it is something to take a look at. Now, these are releases on the bottom there, just generally. They have nothing to do with our transaction, but I did check and just click on those briefly and just see if that's any helpful information. Sometimes the release will have the wrong book and page on there, accidentally off by a number or a digit. You'll see that oftentimes when you're missing a release. So you want to take a look at that. Another thing to note is, just because this is Harford County, you notice that I also said Howard County accidentally. But sometimes when they're putting things together, they forget the right county and put that on the deed of trust, or sorry, the release rather, and the release will be recorded in the incorrect county because they think it belongs in a different county. So Baltimore County, Baltimore City, Harford County, Howard County, some things are on the edge of different counties, and it makes it seem as though it is in a different area when it's not. Definitely a clue for that would be an address. So you want to check on those things as well. What you want to figure out next is who paid off this loan, who's responsible for the release of the mortgage. And now we can take a look at the refinance affidavit, because that will give us evidence of what we need to look for to find out who paid off this loan, because ultimately we can ask them to help us with the release, right? So that's what we're going to do. Now, Bay Home Title also did the subsequent release, payoff of the former mortgage. You see Bay Home Title up at the top there. And if you take a look towards the back of the deed of trust, you're going to have to scroll past a few pages in the land records and see that our unreleased mortgage was paid off by them per their declaration in the refinance affidavit that you see there recorded on page 714. And again, this is a re-recording. Now, if you also take a look, you have, let's see here, we have file number again and the name of the title company. You also have what's called a MIN number. If you don't know what a MIN number is, I'm going to teach you. This is very good information to know because you can find out where this information is now. So here we have the mortgage number. It's a unique 18-digit number used to track mortgages throughout its life. Sometimes you'll see that MERS fee on a deed of trust, or I'm sorry, HUD 1 or CD. And those things indicate that there'll be a MIN number or MERS number on the actual deed of trust, and it tracks the history of the mortgage all the way until it's closed, or what they call inactive. And so you can go onto the MERS website and type in that number, and this is free. Once you have that information, you can type it in and it will pull up whether it's inactive or where it was last when it was paid off. And all that information is really helpful to see which company should I be calling for a release. Now, if you don't know who the exact lender is, you'll have people who have multiple mortgages and multiple properties. They just don't remember who they paid off. I'm sure you've had that situation before. The next thing you want to do is just see, well, what can we do to figure that out together? So the MERS phone number, if you call them, it's kind of hard to get a human. And so I just share this information in case you're interested in giving them a call, because if a bank is a failed bank or receivership does not exist anymore, and the lender is not in business, you'll have to contact someone, right? So MERS can actually give you a mortgage release. So that's something maybe some of you did not know. And sometimes it's hard to get a person on the phone. One of my clients even actually called me and said, hey, do I need a membership to actually get a human on the phone? And the answer is no. So here's this information. It was a little difficult to obtain. So if you have a question about that, we can add that later on to the comment section. MERS, we want to request the release directly from them. But remember, if it was not paid off to a handler of a failed bank, then they're not going to handle that for you. But what they can tell you is who was last responsible for that mortgage. And so that's helpful to track that down. Here's what it looks like on the MERS website. You just enter the 18-digit MIN number and you hit search. In our case, this is our detail that we were looking for on this mortgage. And you'll see it says it's inactive. And the reason why is because it was paid off. Most of you know that NationStar Mortgage is that phone number there, or handled by Bank of America, I believe, at this point. So you'll have to call Bank of America for that information. If you've never used, I guess we have here a polling question, actually. I'll cue Anshi in, and I'll have you guys answer that question.
Thanks, Aaron. I'm going to go ahead and initiate and launch the first polling question. Question number one is, have you ever used MERS or MERS to obtain a release? Feel free to respond and I will share the results. All righty, we have about 87% of the vote in. All right, just waiting on the last couple of folks with 90%, and I will go ahead and close out the poll currently. Share the results with everyone. It looks like it's a 70-30 split of 70 of no and 30% yes.
That's great. I'm surprised it is actually that high for how many of you have actually gotten one. So good job on educating yourselves on that, and having the right people in your office to know that. Moving on, you all may know of require and how to sort of track things in your system after release should be obtained after your mortgage has been paid off by your company. But they also do release tracking before a settlement. So if you get desperate enough and you want to hire someone to take care of this for you, require is a solution and option to get that done. Lender tracking. Just because the loan was paid off to a certain lender doesn't mean that the lender still exists or that they weren't bought out by another bank. So, for example, all first loans are handled by M&T because they bought them out in 2003. You need to identify who holds the loan now so that you can request and obtain that mortgage release. And you want to provide as much information as possible that you can find. Remember, we looked at the loan number that was on the deed of trust that's unreleased. That particular loan number may be helpful as long as it wasn't sold to another bank. And so that's where it gets a little hairy as to when you can dig in later. We'll get into more details on that. You can get a release by trustee. This is helpful, especially when you have a private mortgage where individuals are holding a loan or a seller take back situation, things like that. And you can't find the mortgage holder or they are deceased. And so you want to see, hey, can I contact the trustee and verify that they'd be willing to release the mortgage? So you can call them and ask them if you can find them. So hopefully it's a good thing for you guys. Now, most of you know this, but releases on the due and payable clause in a deed of trust is a due and payable date. You can add 12 years to the expiration date of a mortgage. And if there's nothing else going on in the land records, like an extension of the lien or a modification or anything like that that has been filed, and you don't see any foreclosure actions, you can say that it's done. And it's automatic. You don't have to worry about it. The mortgage is as old as the hills, if you excuse the expression there. Here we have what that looks like in the deed of trust. It's usually on page 2. The borrower's paid off the debt, and well, they're supposed to have paid off that debt by April 1st, 2018 in this particular example. And that will help you with, you know, seeing where you are with that if it's been 12 years afterwards. Now, we're not due on this one, it looks like, until April 1st or 2nd. So here we go with this. These are other options for releases, release by paid and canceled note, release by paid and canceled mortgage or deed of trust, and then you have to attach an affidavit to some of this, and paid and canceled check as well. You can click on the link to look further into how you do that by clicking that or just typing into Google Real Property 3-105 Maryland. Okay. So remember, when you're instructing the borrower to look in their records, they don't actually understand a lot of the jargon that we use. And so we want to use all of the language that you would use, but carefully, and just sort of slow down and explain that to them. Remember that they don't actually know the professional language that we use all the time. Some people are very educated and they know that. And some people are not. And so you want to just slow down because you're looking for a release, and you're going to have to refer to those things as any title that you would think of that could help you. So here's a list for, again, the paid and canceled note and the payoff check by canceled note. Release by canceled check to the note. So you can actually get a release done by paid and canceled check with proof that a release should be filed but is not obtainable through the lender. Again, just a reminder that your client may not understand the jargon, and you have certificate of satisfaction of release. These are the things that you'll be asking the borrower to find for yourself. So if they have the note or the deed of trust or mortgage that's marked satisfied, that would be great, and so on here. The reason why we want the originals, of course, is because we can use them as the actual release and file them in the land records, and that takes care of the problem. The other things that you want them to look for are secondary but important if you're not successful in finding the first three in their paperwork. Now, paid in full letter, mortgage statements, closing disclosure, HUD 1 settlement statement, make sure that they understand that those things are the same, the HUD 1 and the settlement statement, but that they may find them in different terminology there, or they may know them as different, whichever way that they remember. because they don't know the jargon. Now, the 1098 mortgage interest statement from that payoff year is really great because that's a tool most people don't think about. But we'll get into that in just a minute. This is what a paid in full deed of trust looks like. You see the stamp there and the signatures below in blue. That's what it's supposed to look like. This is actually very old, but I just looked online to see if I can find one of those for you guys. Again, they're looking through their records. The faster that you get to this, the better, because people are packing up their things if it's a sale and putting them into storage or putting them on a moving truck and sending them down the road because, you know, they're getting ready to sell their house. So if you want them looking through their documents, the faster you deal with release issues, the better. And so these are the things, once again, that you can do. Now, if they're having a hard time finding their HUD-1 settlement statement or CD, you can ask them to look at their tax paperwork from that year, because that's where they put their paperwork from when they're doing their taxes. They're looking at those numbers and they're throwing them out of the folder that the title company has given them or law firm, and they don't remember that they moved it. And so that would be helpful because it will show where the mortgage was paid off to. And it may not have a loan number on it, doesn't usually on the settlement statement or CD, but it will show you how much was paid, and it can give you an idea of when the loan was paid off within a few days, a week or two of closing. They should have registered, they being the bank, that this was paid off and that they owe a release to the borrower and or the title company who paid it off and is working on that now. Now, tax records is where they can pull interest statements for that year. If they don't have them anymore, they don't know where they are, they may actually call their tax accountant and handle that. So hopefully that's helpful to you. Now, there's a timely review of the title search. I already told you that, you know, that time is of the essence in dealing with these things. We don't know with COVID even how these the offices of the bank is handling their short staff and answering the phones, and all of that is pretty much non-existent a lot of times for release departments, as you know, and it's really important to sort of get their attention as quickly as you can. This is what a 1098 interest statement looks like. If you have a home, you'll know what that is. Some of you don't. And you'll see at the bottom left-hand corner, it'll say account number. The account number is really important because that's what you need to give the bank in order to give you that release. If they can find the loan number, it's a lot easier. You know, you have to give them the social security number and account number when you're trying to get a release. If you can have, if you have that information, it's very good to have for moving forward. Now, the 1098 interest statement from that tax year, if you don't know which one the bank was, which bank was paid off, if you have more than one and you have one house that was sold, chances are one of those interest statements is the one that you're looking for. And so you just have them pull the interest statements from that tax year. If they don't know what year it was paid off and you can't sort of narrow it down, once you've done your research like we did a little bit ago and figured out approximately when the mortgage was paid off, that will help you sort of narrow down the time frame and what you're asking them to look for. Typically, people keep their taxes for 7 years, and some people like to keep them for longer, and you might actually be in luck with that. So if you can get a loan number from them, that's really helpful. Keep your tips on what to do with different banks. It's really good to have a list of helpful human contacts that you build over time, because the next time you have a release for that company, it might be really helpful to be able to pick up the phone and say, this person helped me last time. I wonder if they'll answer the phone and help me just as quickly, and I won't have to navigate through the big pile of paperwork in the back office that someone has in the order that they are received. So with the release, you need to let them know when you need it, and being desperate and letting them know that is actually okay. Because if you let them know when you need it by, they may actually pick it up and say, okay, I've got to work on this one first because it's priority. There's a moving van in the driveway. So don't assume the person in the release department actually understands the bank's acquiring history. So it's helpful in your cover letter when you're asking for this information to say, okay, First National Bank was bought by AllFirst. AllFirst was bought by M&T, and that's why M&T needs to give us a release. We know that the mortgage was paid off to First National Bank and by receivership in the chain of history there. I need you to help with that, okay? The other thing you want to do is attach the deed of trust that paid off the loan and the release affidavit that we talked to you about, the refinance affidavit rather, and that can show them that it was paid off at that time. So that's sort of evidence in past history to help you get through that process quicker. You just want to walk them through it when you fax the information over and just sort of break it down like we discussed. And remember that you get more bees with honey than you do vinegar, right? So be the bee and say please. Let them know when you need to buy, stick to that date you need to buy, be as nice as you can. Remember that they can't read your niceness unless you make it clear that you're trying to just let them know it's urgent, but that you're not being, you know, rude. So urgent and please help is great to put at the top of a release cover letter, letting them know exactly what the property address is, the borrower's name, library folio, deed of trust, everything that you would need to compile a release, put that right on the first page that you fax over to them, because that is helpful to sort of get things done quicker. They'll say, oh, this is an easy one. I'm going to pop this right out. They have a loan number. They know who the borrower is. Here's a social. They even gave me that. I should be able to find this loan. I'm going to work on this one first. So they can't read your tone on paper, but just it's okay to be desperate and let them know you need something. Now, I don't always tell them what date I'm going to close because I want it probably a week at least before settlement. So I'll tell them, hey, it's closing, you know, in 7 days when it's really going to be 14. I know that's not right, but, you know, we all have to get our jobs done. And I think that's really the need by date. And that's a good thing to have because realtors and everything, they don't know the process behind the scenes of what we're doing here, like we're discussing, but it's really good to have that information just to move forward. And remember, they're all watching how quickly and how you're handling their client. These are specific cases that we're going to dig in now for what happens if. Right now, you may not know that the FDIC can help you obtain a mortgage release. And if the actual mortgage company was shut down, like Taylor Bean and Whitaker was, I think it was around 2008 or 9, you know, you can ask the FDIC for an actual release and they will give it to you. A lot of you may not know that, but that's a good thing to know. And these are sort of the qualifications, if you will, for what you do with that lien release, okay? Remember that the failed banks and things like that, they'll take care of that as long as it was paid off to the failed bank, okay? Because they're placed in the FDIC receivership, they will release it for you. This is the link to get a release from the FDIC and a list of failed banks from the Wikipedia. If you're not sure, if you've never heard of the bank, and it's been forever, you just want to know what the chain of history is, that can help you with determining if the FDIC is the one to help you with that information. Here's another polling question, so I'll refer to Anshi.
Wonderful. So we're on polling question number 2 right now, and I'm going to launch it right for the audience. Did you know you can obtain a release from the FDIC? I personally did not know that. I learned something new today. And we got about 90% of the vote in, so we're going to go ahead and close out the poll in a few more moments. All right, closing out right now, and I'll share with the audience the results. Looks like 64% said no, and 36% said yes.
I'm glad to help you with that. That's good to know. Okay. So a lot of times you'll find a title company is closed and you don't know where they kept their records. You can't call a person and say, what did you do with this file? Why is it not released? And can you provide some information so that we can get to closing? But you're not out of luck. Just remember that you do need to refer to the borrower's records as much as you can, but you're not as desperate as you think a lot of times. So just remember, start with the borrower's records. Hopefully they're willing to help you if you're clear enough to tell them, hey, if you don't help us, then we're not going to probably close on time. So I need you really to take this serious, you know, and work in that paperwork. And reminder, settlement statements, CD, and interest statements are from that tax year. With the title company closing, finding that records, maybe they're old and they're thrown out a long time ago. Remember that their tax accountant may have some paperwork from that year. It's a long shot, but you never know. What do you know already? Just remember, if you're digging in, you've already done the steps that we've already gone through. You have a lot of information already. You most likely know when the loan was paid off, approximately, if you see that refinance affidavit, and you most likely can move forward with that information, at least seeing, is that bank the one that was supposed to be paid off, by going to Payoff Assist as well. Payoff Assist can let you know a chain of history for example, First National Bank of Maryland going to AllFirst, going to M&T Bank. Some people just know that automatically, but some people don't, and it's really good to be able to sort of check that out. On the refinance affidavit and the affidavit of consideration, if you're trying to dig in and find out information, maybe there is a file out there that has that release and it just never got recorded. There's a lot of title companies out there that are guilty of just throwing the release in the file and shutting the drawer and not doing anything with it. So hopefully that's not you guys, but that's helpful to sort of think about. If you can find that file, at least you'll be able to see the proof of payoff, settlement statement most likely, and be able to move forward with that. On the refinance affidavit and the affidavit of consideration, what you see right here with our fabulous unreleased mortgage we talked about before, we can see that Todd Mullinex was the notary here, and you can see Steve Hoffman was saying they were responsible for dispersing the loan, which was our payoff of the unreleased mortgage. Now we can see, what do we do with that information? We want to gather those names and see, do we know this person? Do we think that they moved on to a different company? Can we find them online? Do a quick Google search. See if the same location may have a just different name. So you can look and see, you know, on LinkedIn and Facebook. Use the private functions of private messenger, phone numbers that are listed online for them. Even just saying where they work, you can actually look that up. I once looked up phone numbers for two 70-year-old gentlemen who were brothers in a unreleased mortgage situation where it was a private mortgage, and we're trying to find them. I was able to find their son, one of the brothers' sons, and give him a call using the work phone number that I could find on Google, because they said they worked at this place on Facebook, and explain the situation to them and ask them to reach out to me so that my client could help get help with their release. And we had a release within a day when my client had been looking for over a month to find that information. So just think about, what information do you have, and sort of put your little investigator hat on and really look online to see what you can dig in to find. The other option would be your Band-Aid, right? The letter of indemnity, which is simply a wish granted to get to settlement. That's the nice version. The other is a very detailed letter explaining that the underwriter is okay with you going to closing, and that they will insure over the transaction because they issued a loaner's policy, and that they're basically on the hook for obtaining that release for you. This is what you should know about an indemnity letter. An indemnity letter is actually considered a claim if you're the title company that has an indemnity letter issued for something that you didn't get released, it's actually considered a claim. Some people don't realize that. And it is something that the internal discussions of the underwriter consider when it comes to different reviews of the agents annually. And so we refer as an underwriter to make sure that those things are taken care of by our clients. And if their letter of indemnity is issued to another company, we aren't expecting the title company or law firm to actually take care of that because it was issued and it is not a permanent fix. Some people think that a letter of indemnity is a permanent fix, but you actually might have a purchaser of a property who is not okay with that letter of indemnity not being cleared, and they view it as an issue, and or the lender could have an issue with it being listed as an exception, or you know, that they want it to be cleared. Depends on the lender. So you might want to consider that as you're shoving the letter of indemnity back in your drawer and saying, I'll get to another day. Your underwriter certainly doesn't look at it as another day item. They would like you to work on that one as quickly as possible. Most of you know that anyway, and you're doing very well. Obviously, with the insurance policy, any claim is something that we want to have reviewed because the maximum claim amount on the policy might not be enough to insure over the issue, such as a loan being more than the value of the owner's policy. So we want to make sure that those things are resolved as quickly as you can. Most of you have seen the indemnity letter, but I just sort of took some fun here and showed you what it might be like if Mr. and Mrs. Claus were purchasing a property from Rudolph Doe and Clarice Doe for $25,000 on December 25th. And you'll see these mortgages here listed. They, of course, are fake, but just as a little fun example of what that might look like and the language and the defects and all of that, because those potentially could be enforced if they were not paid off. You're assuming the title company did their job and paid off that loan, and the underwriter is as well, but they're saying they're on the hook for it anyway. And these are sort of the last phrases of the underwriter who is insuring over the transaction with the owner's policy that existed on a former owner. And you just want to just check with those things to see that everything looks good and everybody's names and everything is listed correctly, and you're good to go. Here's when a letter of indemnity is not helpful and not to waste your time. If you know that a mortgage was paid off on a refinance and the borrower that's in title is the borrower on the unreleased mortgage, they're not going to help you. You're not going to get a letter of indemnity on a lender's title insurance policy because it's just not insuring the borrower. And so it's usually only on a situation for the former owner's mortgage when it comes to the unreleased mortgage. Now, other lien situations, that's a whole nother issue. And just wanted to let you know that you're wasting your time if you're asking for an underwriter's help to get your release done and or letter of indemnity. Okay, so if you can't find the title insurance who paid off the unreleased mortgage, that's not really a good thing. Hopefully you can figure out which underwriter it was, because if it's a closed title company, chances are the underwriter might have their files. So if they're shut down, they might have collected their files and kept them in their back office somewhere. So you might find that file with that release sitting in that fabulous file and get the job done. So just call and see if you can figure out where the title company, which underwriter they had at the time, or which ones that they had at the time, and just what do you do here. If you know who they are, you can request permission from that same underwriter to close if it's the LOI, and of course, again, not with the refi situation. If not, just keep on plugging along and see what you can do with the information you have. Now we have polling question number 3.
Great. Go ahead and initiate polling question number 3. Question is, have you ever needed help with obtaining a difficult unreleased mortgage? I'm We got about 83% voted already, so we'll give a few more moments for the rest to respond. Alrighty, I'm going to go ahead and close out the poll. And I'll share with everyone the results. It looks like 100% said yes. Oh, I think that also is a testament to why we're having this webinar.
Right, exactly. And I would love for this to help you guys with your happy dance at the end of the day when you get that wonderful letter by FedEx or UPS that says, here's your release. The whole office goes wild, if you will. And that's what we want, right? To help you guys out. And that's the whole purpose of this seminar. Now, as for your internal office, you want to just look at your policies and procedures and just make sure that you are actually getting releases on your mortgages that you've paid off in a timely way so that you don't have this reputation out there. And so just checking on that and seeing how you can handle those things instead of calling it, employees' job security, as one employer might have called it. So they didn't hire any tracking service or handling any of that. They just sort of said, well, when we're slow, we'll handle things on an as needed basis and sort of clear up the 2005 files that we didn't take care of. Your underwriter really doesn't want to hear that. So they really want to know that you're taking care of those things, because one day it could be a problem and you don't want to have that problem. So here we go. The lender wants to make sure all the documents are recorded. And of course, the release is something that the title company promised would be done. So just letting you know that, you want to make sure that the proper county is on the release once you get it to prevent an issue of rejection or it not being satisfactory so that it's done correctly. Consider whether you want to work with a release tracking company if you didn't know that was a possibility, or if that you could even hire a company to help you with that. That is something that you could do to help with your due diligence process and not have concerns after a transaction is finalized, because realtors talk and so do other title companies. And I think all of us know of a title company or two who literally doesn't care about their release process after settlement. They've got paid, they're moving on, they don't care. Hopefully that's not you guys. And if it is, maybe you can think about ways that can clean that up as quickly as possible. The best practice, of course, from Alta explains to do it on time and to do it right. How you do it is, how you have your policy and you just make it a priority as a process that you do in your office. And that can help with a lot of your brand reputation. Remember, realtors talk, title companies talk, and you don't want your reputation to be, hey, that title company over there doesn't care after settlement is done, they're done, and they don't care about the releases. And I keep having to call over there and say, hey, where's this release for this file that was paid off 10 years ago? You don't want to be on the naughty list, because that's a lost opportunity. You want to be on the nice list. How you get on the nice list is to basically do your job effectively and have your good reviews. Don't forget that when you're the hero, they can leave you a nice review, and when you're the zero, that negative review can really hurt your reputation. Millennials are the ones that are buying most homes, at least they were before COVID. Average age of a buyer is 31, and those people are looking online to see what your company's doing. Your reputation is very important. Maybe the difference between getting a client or not. So I want to thank you all for letting me do this for you. Helping you guys be better at what you do is our job, and we're lucky to have you, and we really appreciate your business. And now I'll just open it up to questions.
Thank you, Sarah, for that presentation. We still have a little bit of time, so yes. Looking at the questions in the chat boxes, I don't have anything asked currently.
Okay.
Give a few moments for folks to respond in or to enter their questions in. With title insurance and title industry, explicitly, we're so in the weeds with the details. And while releases and having difficulty with releases are not the sexiest of topics to discuss. You hit the nail right in the head at the top of the hour, and saying that you know, this is an encumbrance to the transaction being consummated. You can't really continue on and ensure that sure the transaction without this information.
Right, so, that's correct, Anshi. A lot of times the borrower may decide whether or not they want to move forward. And with this market, you just never know if a borrower is just not going to want to wait to get into your house. They may say, okay, you have a problem with title. You haven't resolved it. End of transaction, contract void. We're done. And that's not something you want to hear after you've worked so hard to get through that transaction and the liability involved and everything. So borrowers have to work hard on helping you with that because that's part of their job to fulfill the contract. So.
Of course. So we have a few questions that came in. One of the audience members asked, can you reiterate the way MERS gets the release? Do you mind going over those slides?
Yes. So there's a process on the MERS website, and it runs you through how to request a release from them. And you can only get a release if the bank is closed and no one has received the files of that company. And so, for example, Taylor, Bean, and Whitaker would be FDIC, but some banks just never, you know, they just never continued and that was it. They were done. So if there's a MERS number on there, you can request MERS to release it instead of the company that might have held it because they don't exist anymore. So that's when you find the bank that doesn't exist anymore, but you have a release. Now what? That's sort of a helpful information for moving forward. Does that answer your question?
Oh, I believe so. Just the general outline of that. I think there was a number of folks that didn't know that MERS could even do that. So that was helpful.
I didn't either when I first started teaching this. This one of my clients actually shared it with me. I will say Progressive Title and Severna Park gave that information to me, so I can't take credit
for that. Well, it's good. Sharing the wealth.
Definitely. If anyone else has things they'd like to share, that would be helpful. I'm all at yours as well.
Of course. We had another question. What will the signed HUD with payoff amount for unreleased lien do for them?
Well, you can prove to the bank that it was paid off and closed. Hopefully that it was closed. If it was a HELOC, then you have a whole other question as to whether or not it was still open and rung up again. That happens occasionally, and that's where the lender looks at the lender's insurance, or the title company asks the underwriter to look at that transaction and help them with it. But you want to prove to the bank in as quick as possible terms that the loan was paid off and when it was paid off. So you can have an indicator there. That's why you would want that information even from another title company if they'll allow you to have it. So you can at least have that information and possibly even ask your own underwriter if they would be okay with closing without the release if they have that documentation, because there is an agreement between underwriters on occasion, an off situation, just to allow that to go forward. So it might be worth even asking your underwriter, hey, can I close even though we know this is happening? And if so, what are the conditions? Some conditions might be an escrow or a certain amount of money to sit there until it's done. I've seen that once, but it's rare, very rare. But we just have to get really creative on that. Thanks for your question.
Yeah, that's a really good question. One more, since we have a little bit of time left. Is there any way to get a release from the state of Maryland for a state chartered bank that may have failed?
I would check with, start with Payoff Assist, put the bank's name in, and check that out. Also check Wikipedia if the bank's name is there as a failed bank, and then move forward with that information. Then go to MERS if they have a MIN number or MERS number. That would be great. Check and see if they can tell you when it was paid off. I mean, not when, well, I could say when. The last date on there, I think I saw there was a date. So that it was inactive at some point, you can actually refer to that. And if the bank's no longer in existence, MERS could possibly give you a release. So that's a good one.
Right. And we have one more, a little bit less of a question, more of a request. Was it, can you please provide the link for the FDIC contact info and list of failed banks?
Sure. Let me get back to that. Sorry, guys. I know, there it is.
I would say we can always reach out to the specific question asker, if that's a real word, with that, sure, with this link as well, because it's a little bit long here and we're not, yes, expecting you to jot it down. If you're able to take a screenshot, great, but we can definitely follow up with that fashion as well.
Sure.
Also, this is being recorded, everyone, so if I would advise you to actually, you know, get a recording of this as well, because if you ever have to refer back to specifically the links or anything, you know, to that matter, you'll have the information handy just with a click. So just want to let everybody know that.
Correct, Ron. Yes, this webinar and all of our educational webinars will be recorded and published to our eSecurity Title website under the video section. We usually upload them within 24 to 48 hours after the event, so they're up pretty quickly. So you'll have the slide deck there and be able to rewatch it for any questions, lingering questions. And of course, you have Sarah and Ron's contact information as well, if you want to reach out to them directly.
Right. I don't mind helping any of you. If you have a specific question, you just want a third person to sort of run it through, I'm happy to help you with that.
Well, we've come to the end of the questions here, so I'll kick it off to Sarah and Ron for any last parting words before we depart.
I just want to thank everybody for allowing me to do this, helping you guys.
Okay. I as well would like to thank everybody for attending, and a special thanks to Sarah for a wonderful presentation. I actually learned a lot from here as well, and I think I'm hoping you all have too. Like I said, I think the best thing is to definitely get a recording of this. I think it's going to be helpful. Sarah and I are always here to help you. If it's a legal question, and you know, we generally will not answer that for you, but our legal department will gladly answer that as well. I want you all to also, if you wouldn't mind, please keep an eye out for next month's webinar announcement. And everybody have a great day and a great rest of the week. And it was great getting back to our monthly webinars. Sarah, thank you so much again. You did a great job.
Thank you. All right, everybody. Thanks again.